Good morning, Vernal Christian Church. Good to see you guys, and for everybody joining in online, welcome. Thanks for being here. Man, I don't know about you, but I'm just excited. I'm excited to get right into it. I'm very excited to not have Gatorade poured all over my head. Let's just establish that rule right now. It's Super Bowl Sunday. If you saw the Facebook post, I am so glad you want to like cheer for me. We don't need the Gatorade though, okay? Somebody made a post saying, you know, in celebration, let's pour Gatorade. It's new carpet. They told me we can't do it. I'm so sorry. Hey, we're going to worship and we're going to praise. And so I want to do it backwards order. I want to praise first. And then we're just going to continue that praise through worship. So would you just join me in prayer this morning as we just thank God for everything he gives us? Amen? Amen. Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are just so thankful. We're so thankful that you are alive, that you are real, and that your love is here and in this place, and you are moving in our lives. And so, God, we just come willing to give you all of that praise and more. God, we want this day to be a day of celebration, not just celebration on our teams or our players or who made the best food, but we want to give all praise and all glory to you just now. So thank you for this time we have together to join as one body, one set of believers, completely focused on you and declare your glory for everything you do. God, we love you. It's in the powerful name of Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Hey, as we start off, if you've got those salmon colored cards, we would love to connect with you. If you're watching on Facebook, feel free to drop us any new contact info you may have so we can keep in touch with you. Also, prayer requests, we would love to just celebrate not only your praises, but be by your side in the midst of your battles. With that, let's worship.
We'll ask you to please stand with us. Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. Oh, you are my portion. You are my hiding place. And I believe you are the way, the truth, life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. And I believe through every blessing, through every promise, through every breath I take, I believe that you are provider. Oh, you are protector. You are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I am here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the light. I believe you are the way, truth, the life, I believe you are.
Your name.
There is no fear, 'cause I believe. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. I have a hope found in I have a strength found in your grace, your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire, do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. In you, God, I believe. In you, release your love inside of unleash your power for all to see. Spirit, come and fall on us over and over. Oh Lord, make way through the waters, walk me through the fire, do what you are famous for, what you are. Lord, you will never fail. Your name is powerful. Your word's unstoppable. All things are possible in you. In you, God. God, I believe in you. There is no fear, for I have seen. There is no doubt, 'cause I have seen your faithfulness, my fortress, over and over. Make way through the waters, walk me through the fire. Do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Shut the mouths of lions, bring dry bones to life, and do what you are famous for, what you are famous for. Walk me through the
thankful to be in your house. We're thankful to be in your presence. And we just ask you, Lord God, right now, if there's anyone in this house who doesn't know of your redeeming grace, of the blood shed on the cross by Jesus, of the sacrifice made by the Lamb, if they don't understand their need for a Lord and a Savior of their life, I pray right now, Lord God, that you would just permeate their thoughts and their heart and everything that is about them, and to show them their need for a Lord and a Savior in their life. We love you, we praise you, and it's in the mighty name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Hey, please be seated. There's no ascent today because I get to preach. We're going into a time of communion, so if you didn't get the chance yet, there are little prepackaged communions available just right there on the back table.
As we're about to partake, I want to read a few scriptures. The first one's going to be John 3:16-17. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Also, 1 Corinthians 11:23-26. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again."
Let's pray. Father, thank you for sending your son to die on a cross so that we might have life. Amen. How embarrassing, the preacher forgot to bring up communion. But I didn't forget to bring my tithes and offerings. So as we move into this time of offering, if you're a guest with us here this morning, please hear. We don't want you to feel in any way obligated to take part in this service. In this part of the service, this is just for us who call VCC home. And so I want to just remind you of 2 Corinthians 9:7, where Paul says, and he tells us, thanks, Carl, I'll do that during offering. He says, each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. That's who we want to be as a church. That's who we want to be as a family. We want to give, and we want to give cheerfully. And so I just want to remind you of the three ways you can give. You can give by either going online to kindredgiving.com/Vernal Christian Church. You can also give by using our texting platform. Information's on the screen. And you can always mail in checks or cash to Vernal Christian Church. If you prepared those in person this morning, there's a basket for tithe and offerings on your way out. I'm going to have Micah just pray a blessing over these offerings, and then after he's done praying, I'm going to give you a little time to prepare those. So, Micah, if you would.
Dear Lord, I pray that you bless our tithes and offerings and those that offer them to you, Lord, and I also pray that you be with Kyle today and just give him strength and just help them to touch everybody's heart that's here, Lord, and thank you and amen.
Amen. Awesome. Perfect. Thanks, Micah. Hey, I also wanted to give you just a quick announcement of some things going on. The big one I want you to be reminded of is there is a ladies' fellowship brunch, breakfast. You'll probably stay till lunch. We'll call it brunch. It's this Saturday, 9 a.m. You can sign up. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. But also just know if you don't sign up, show up, please. It's just a time to get to know each other, to just eat and fellowship and just enjoy the time. So it's at 9 a.m. here at the church. If you've got kids, bring them, okay? They can run and play together while you eat and just get some enjoyment. Here's what I want to do this morning. I want to just fully embrace the emotions and the feelings in this room this morning. Immediately, the men are like, what? We're just going to embrace what's here. So here's what I want you to do. If you have anything on your person and it's normally on one side, I want you to switch it. So for example, if you wear a wedding ring, you're shaking your head. If you wear a wedding ring, I want you to take it off and I want you to put it on your other hand. And it's just going to feel weird, and it's okay. Ladies, if you have a bracelet or a watch that you use on one hand, switch it to the other. Like, do it. This is not rhetorical. Do it. Fellas, stand up. If you've got a wallet in your back pocket, switch pockets. If you've got keys or phones in your pocket, switch them. I just want everything to be moving around. Switch sides. And it's going to feel weird. It's going to seem off. It might even be a little awkward when in 5 minutes you go to look at your phone and stay of paying attention to me. You're going to go, where's my phone? I've lost my phone. You don't need your phone. Focus. It's going to seem weird, and it's going to feel off. It might even be a little awkward. But let's be honest, where we're at right now as a church, as a family, seems a little weird. It might feel a little off. Let's just embrace the awkwardness. I have no idea what this sermon is going to do for you this morning. I should know because I know where it's headed. I don't have a clue. I don't know what you're going to take away from the message this morning, but I know three things. One, we need to hear it from God. Two, we need to affirm it. Amen. That's how it works. Affirm. You say yes. And number three, I just want us to rest assured in the promise that God gives us. In Exodus chapter 13, we're going to look at it later on, but God tells his people, don't be afraid. The Lord your God will fight for you today. Just stay calm. Amen. While you're finishing getting those offerings together, watch this video. Exciting? Yes? Hey, this is our new series. This is where we're going. And over the next 4 weeks, you're going to get to hear from all kinds of different people. And we're going to look at this topic of I believe God. And we're going to finish that sentence and make it a statement. Make sense? Next 4 weeks, I believe God blank. And we're going to fill that blank in for you. And I understand those three words alone is a lot. If you have never spoken those three words, you might already be thinking, okay, this isn't for me. Here's my challenge for you this morning. I want you to come back all 4 weeks. If you have never spoken, I believe God, I want you to come back each week for 4 weeks. And if you have questions each and every Sunday afterwards, I want you to grab me. I want you to grab whoever brought you. I want you to ask those questions because thankfully our God gives us answers. Amen? But here's the deal. While I was thinking of this message, coming back to those who call VCC home, I want you to know I wrote this for you. With you in mind and with where we are as a family, I want us to be able to already understand that we are here today, we are unified in the fact that we believe God. Somebody say amen. 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 If you want to follow along with the message this morning, we're going to be in the book of Exodus. And so if you have your Bibles, if you want to turn there, if you didn't bring one, scriptures are going to be on the screen. You'll be able to follow along just fine. But we're going to go to Exodus, and if you would, turn to chapter 13. I love the story that the Israelites made in the book of Exodus. And I think it's so important to us for today for two reasons. And the first one is this. I think the story of how the Israelites literally made an exodus, they moved from one thing into something completely unknown, I think it's so relevant to where we are today, yes? Where we are going from one season and now into a new season, and we don't know exactly what it's going to look like, but we know we're moving and we know we're going there. And the second reason I wanted to just pour into Exodus is because it gives us one of the best, most accurate descriptions that God ever gives of himself to us. I did a little research, do your own, let me know what you find out, because it was towards the end of my sermon prep. And apparently, throughout the book of Genesis, God is only ever known by his title. When you read in the beginning God, you read in the beginning Elohim, or El, or all these other adjectives after El to describe God. It means God, it means creator and author of life, but it's a title. And now here in Exodus is the first time he ever tells us his name. And if you know about Moses and the burning bush, you know exactly where I'm going with this. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, God says, I am who I am. Yeah, you said it with me. I love it. Translated from Hebrew, it could also mean I will be what I will be. It's the tetragrammaton, baby. If you don't know what that is, Google it. It's Yod He Vad He. It's Yahweh. Oh, it's this name that Hebrew scholars, that Jews alike, were so like pressured that they wanted to honor God with everything they gave him, that his name, that they didn't even want to pronounce it. They didn't even want to write it down. So a lot of times they used Adonai because it conveyed the same meaning, but his name is so holy, it's so revered. It's almost this breath. Yahweh. It's just supposed to be life. And he tells us his name. And if you were to ask me why I believe God, it's because he is who he is. Repeat after me. God is God, and I am not. That's why I believe God, because he's God, and I'm not. And praise God for it. Amen? Amen. But I'll back up and I'll give you the introduction to the story. Like I said, we're going to be in Exodus 13, so let me recap where we are. In Genesis, it kind of ends with the story of Joseph. Joseph was one of Jacob's 12 sons. He gets sold into slavery by his brothers. He gets sent to jail and then miraculously, read the story in Genesis, I think it's 29 through 50, of Joseph's life. He gets brought into this position where he's second over all of Egypt. And in that position, he is able to not only save all of Egypt from a famine and a drought, but he's able to get his family back to him, and he rescues his family too. And now we pick it up in Exodus chapter 1, where it says, many years passed, and after Joseph died, there were all these new pharaohs, all these new kings who came to power, and they forgot about Joseph. They forgot about everything he had done for them. And what happens is one new pharaoh, I'm here in verse 6, it says, in the time Joseph and all his brothers died, ending that generation, the Israelites multiplied so greatly that they became extremely powerful and they filled the land. So a new king came to power and he said to his people, the Israelites now outnumber us and they're stronger than us. Let's squish them. And so it says here in verse 11, the Egyptians made the Israelites their slaves. I mean, to just go from this place of security to this place of oppression. Long story short, the Pharaoh wants to squish them by making a decree that all Hebrew boys that were born were killed. When the midwives wouldn't do it, he said, toss them in the river. Moses gets born, his mother wanting to save him, puts him in a little basket, sends him down the river. It's Pharaoh's daughter who finds Moses, takes him in as her own son. Moses grows up, and then he kills a guy, he becomes a shepherd, he saves a damsel in distress, has a son, normal things. We've all gone through that phase. Read it, Exodus chapter 2. We get to the end here, and it says this. Years passed and the king of Egypt died, but the Israelites continued to groan under their burden of slavery. They cried out for help and their cries rose up to God. In verse 24, chapter 2, God heard their groaning and he remembered his covenant promise to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. He looked down on the people of Israel and knew it was time to act. He knew it was time to act. A lot of versions will say God looked down at them. God cared for them. God knew them. I love the NLT. It's time to act. As a parent and you're watching your children, you're always ready for those moments when it's time to act. Yeah? But to the fellas, to the dads, we act a little differently because we have dad reflexes. Come on, dad, say amen. We got those dad reflexes, right? This isn't little concerns like, oh, I wasn't sure if little Timmy had enough vitamin E in his lunch, so I packed. That's not what dad reflexes are, right? Dad reflexes are these adrenaline junkie moments. They're these times where you just snap into superhuman figure and you go and you make these heroic saves. Y'all, I had my first one. I'm so excited. Let me tell you about it, okay? We were at Life Group. We meet in the annex. And as we gather, the children just kind of start to play. And they lose a toy behind like a 6-foot-tall bookshelf, right? And I'm sitting on my seat, and I'm just kind of looking around, listening and talking. And all of a sudden, I look over, and they're trying to get what's behind the shelf, which has stuff on it. And they're starting at the bottom, and they're pushing. What's going to happen? Not today. I see it. I snap. I get there in 2 strides. It was only 3 strides away, but I made it there in 2. I get there. I said, that shelf was going down, y'all. It's tipping like this, and I grab it. And on the outside, I'm like, oof, hey, good thing. On the inside, I'm like, all right, I'll show it to you because you're not picking it up. I'm excited, okay? I found this reenactment, okay? Watch this. I want you to see what's happening here, okay? Here's some kids. They're on a cart. They're going to go down the hill. The father's the one who lets them go, and he notices there's trouble. And he springs in, and he saves the child. Yo, that was me. That was me. Oh, I made it. I saved it. I was like, yes. Oh, yes. I'm a father. But then like 2 weeks later, this is like a week ago, we're shopping, and I've got the cart, and I'm pushing it, and my son's here, and my wife's behind us, and we're going down this aisle, and I turn, and my son doesn't turn, and I smack him with the cart, and here's a reenactment of that moment. Kids playing, having a great time, and I'm not a perfect parent is what I'm trying to say. Side note for the parents in here, I want you to know 2 things. Number one, the Bible never calls you to be a perfect parent. The Bible calls you to point to perfection. Yes? As a parent, it is your job, your responsibility to point your children to Christ. And number 2, I mean it. If Jesus had children, he would have sinned too. You're just going to do it, okay? If Jesus would have had kids, he would have sinned too, all right? Listen, Lord, forgive me, but I lie to my child every single morning. I do. I'm like, yo, buddy, we got to go. You got to hustle. You're late. He's got an hour to get ready, but he doesn't. He don't know that. I'm like, dude, move. That darn Christian private school next door is trying to teach my child how to tell time. Give a dad a break, okay? Come on. I shared this on Facebook earlier this week, just this idea of what children see parents do for them and what we as parents actually do for our children. And I asked you to give me some thoughts, and I just want to share them here in case you didn't get to see that post. The question is, what do your children see you do for them, but what do you actually do for your children? My answer was, my child, my son, he thinks I'm just this bottomless wallet. He don't know I'm broke. Even though I tell him every time, he still thinks it's going to happen today. Not a chance. I'm broke. I'm not a bottomless wallet, but between my wife and I, we have bottomless hearts. And he will never be able to find the extent of how much we really love him. Had some others tell me their responses. One friend said, my child thinks I'm just the Disney remote. You go to me when you want to watch the show, right? But actually, as a parent, who they are, they're the Be Like McKenzie fan club. Their little daughter, McKenzie, their biggest fan club, because they want her to be everything she is in God. Man, parents, the best thing you can do for your children, start a fan club. Especially if you got older, angsty teens, they'll love it. I'm telling you, put their face on a shirt, walk into English class, just, you got this. You can do it. Get kicked out. It's fine. It's all part of being a parent. Another friend said, my child thinks I just have limitless time, that 24/7 I can be there and do what they want. But really, I have limitless caring. And that child will never see the end of how much I care for them. Another friend said, having a daughter is like having a broke friend who thinks you're rich. Okay, going back, children all about money, okay? But then she said, but I'm a mom. Yes, I want to be friendly. Yes, I want to be a friend to my child, but I'm a mom first. You're a mom first. You're a dad first, parents. Last one I have is this one. This friend said, my children think they have to do everything for me, right? So if you ask your child, hey, can you just pick up the toys in your room? Oh, I have to do everything here. She said, but really, as a parent, I would do everything for you. And then she said this. She said, and that made me think about my relationship with God and how some days it just feels like I have to do everything for God. Oh, but then we look at everything God has done for me, for us. Doesn't even compare. That friend was Leona, and she's awesome. You should hang out with her more. She didn't know this, but the point of my message this morning is exactly the point she made. Here's what I believe. I believe God does. I don't know if that's grammatically correct. It's probably not a huge epiphany to any of you, but I think it's a good reminder for us this morning. I believe God does. Why? Because I believe God is alive, and I believe real love is stirring in our hearts, and I believe God is on the move. And if you do too, somebody say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Woo! We're getting excited today, folks, I'm telling you. So here we are, Exodus chapter 13. Let me show you what God does, in case you don't believe me. Long story short, to get from Exodus 2 to Exodus 13, Moses sends him and his brother Aaron to go do some miracles, and God sends some plagues, and everything God does for his people, he does to get him to this point when Pharaoh will finally let the Israelites go so they're not slaves anymore. Here we are, chapter 13, starting in verse 17. It says, when Pharaoh finally let his people go, God didn't lead them along the main road that runs through the Philistine territory. Even though that was the shortest route to the promised land, pause, there's a good sermon in there for you, okay? The shortest route, not always the best route. Amen. Oh, that's fine. Don't believe me. God said, if the people are faced with a battle, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness toward the Red Sea. Thus, the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. Jump down to verse 21. It says, then the Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of cloud, and he provided light at night with a pillar of fire. This allowed them to travel by day or by night, and the Lord God did not remove the pillar of cloud or pillar of fire from its place in front of the people. Did you catch all of that? Are you ready to catch it again in case you missed it? I believe God does. Check this out. I believe God does establish our paths. And some of y'all, right now, you're like, amen, I'm on the path. I know it. Somebody tell me. Thank you. He leads us out of trouble and into good. Who in here is experiencing some good? Say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. The Lord God does prepare us for battle. Man, side note, some of y'all facing some battles, and if you winning, tell us. Because we want to celebrate with you. And if you're struggling, tell us. We want to pray and we want to fight with you. The Lord God does prepare us for battle. Amen. Amen. God goes ahead of us. He guides us. He provides for us. I love this one. He stays with us and he doesn't leave.
Amen.
Thank you. I believe he will do all of that regardless of what you believe.
Amen.
Amen. And I believe that God can and is capable and will do all of that. I am not worried about whether or not God is going to act. I am worried, are we going to be ready? When he's acting, are we going to be ready? So here's what I want to do this morning. You're going to check yourself before you wreck yourself, okay? We're going to check three things. We're going to check our reaction, we're going to check our plan, and we're going to check our position. The first one, we're going to check our reaction. After everything God just did for them, not just Exodus, but all of human history, everything God did for the Israelites to get them to this point. Now check how the Israelites respond. We're in chapter 14, starting in verse 2. Then Lord gave these instructions to Moses, order the Israelites to turn back. Go to verse 3. Then Pharaoh will think the Israelites are confused. They're trapped in the wilderness, and once again I'll harden Pharaoh's heart, and he will chase after you. But I've planned this, God says, in order to display my glory through Pharaoh and his whole army. After this, the Egyptians will know that I am the Lord. God's planned it. Check the reaction. Verse 10, as Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and panicked when they saw the Egyptians overtaking them. They cried out to the Lord and they said to Moses, why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? Oh my gosh, so dramatic. Why did you bring us, what have we done? What have you done for us? Why did you make us leave Egypt? Didn't we tell you this would happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians. It's better to be slaves in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness. Come on! Oh, Israelites, get it together. And I just wonder, is our reaction today going to be the same? Are we so afraid of the bad that might happen? Are we so afraid of the enemy that's charging after us that we're going to completely miss the good that God has planned? We need to check our reaction. Can I give you a quick preaching update? Yeah. Oh, skip the slide. No. many have wondered and many want to know. So I just want to tell you, as far as preaching goes, y'all, we're going to do the same thing we've always done. We're going to join together in fellowship. We're going to center our lives on God's word. And we are going to know him and we are going to make him known. And from the preaching pulpit, you're going to get to hear from a lot of different people. In this series, I Believe God, you're going to get to hear from all three elders. That's Jim Blaine, Kevin Baker, and Drex Bowden. Don't actually skip it, Roxanne. You can go to it. They want this knowledge. Your elders are going to preach, and they're going to finish these statements of I Believe God, and I'm super excited. You're also going to get to hear from some of our other communities. And what I mean by that is you're going to get to hear from people who are in-house, but also people who are connected to us, whether they've had some partnership, some kind of experience, or whether they just know and love VCC. One group is Matthew Anderson and his teaching group at Plant Utah. They have like 6-7 guys who all preach at only a couple different campuses, and they're willing to come out and preach. But here's the deal, church. Check our reaction. I do not want to hear what you liked and what you didn't like. I don't want to hear who you thought was better and who needs to practice a little more. I don't want to hear it. God doesn't want to hear it. Because I'll tell you right now, 2/3 of your elders are very afraid to speak publicly. 2/3 of your elders are more afraid of what will happen if you don't hear God's word. And they are willing to overcome one fear because they are driven for you to know who God is. Somebody say, we love you, elders. Switched it up on you. as far as preaching goes, that's what you're going to see in the next few weeks and months to come. But here's the reaction that God says to his people through Moses. Exodus chapter 14, I'm in verse 13. But Moses told the people, don't be afraid, just stand still. Watch, the Lord will rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again. The Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm. Amen. That is where we need to be. Our first reaction is we have to stay calm. let's check our plan. I think it's interesting there in Exodus chapter 13, it says, thus the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. Here they are, like an army ready for battle, and yet God doesn't send them into battle because they might get scared. So here you guys, these Israelites, they have their armor on, they're leaving home, they're ready for it, but they're not really ready for it, they're shaking in their boots. And there's this gigantic pillar of cloud that's guiding them. It's kind of ridiculous, this battle they're going into, and it made me think about another ridiculous battle. It's the story of Jericho. In Joshua chapter 6, I'll just kind of recap it for you. This happens much after this moment in Exodus. Once Moses passes away and Joshua is leading the people and they're going into the promised land finally, right? That good that God has established their path to be on. And in the way is the city of Jericho. It's these Canaanites, these bad guys. I mean, big, tough, bad, you know, like bad. They're right there in the middle, and God says, you're going to conquer them. And so he tells the Israelites, you're going to go, you're going to prep for battle, you're going to get there. You know what you're going to do? March. What? There's these huge city walls around Jericho. And God says, every single day for 6 days, you're just going to walk around those walls. That's all you're going to do. Then on the seventh day, you're going to walk around those walls 7 times. And when you hear the horns blast, you shout. That's ridiculous. You kind of want to know if it would work, though, right? Let's look at our walls. Let's look at what we're up against, right? First one, economy. Don't you wish you could just take all of those bills, put them in the center of your living room, and just go, okay, they are not my problem. Unemployment, our jobs, stimulus checks, this whole economy. I mean, it's standing right in our way. What else do we, health, right? COVID, I'm sorry, it has to be in every sermon, but it's where we're at. Our globe, our nation. I missed the blip earlier. In case you didn't hear, our elder Jim Blaine is in the hospital right now. He went to the ER this morning. He's not doing good with COVID. Can we just pray for him real quick? Please. Heavenly Father, God, knowing you are a God of miracles, we're pleading that you do it again right now here for Jim. And not just for Jim, but our other family and friends who are just fighting. And they need just a break. So God, intervene, do a miracle of healing, and give them grace and peace today. Amen. Amen. State of our nation. Again, every sermon, but it's where we're at. Division, unrest, what the future holds. The last one is our church, right? Where are we going? What's coming next? Can I give you a quick transition update? Yes. Thank you. here's what you should know. Your transition team here at the church, they started back November 2019. The team was formed through a lot of prayer and a lot of following God's calling. There are 9 people who have been pouring out for over a year. And those 9 people started in April 1st of 2020 accepting applications. And we've worked and we have gathered and we have gained. And just since the top of the new year, just since January 1st, here's what our team is doing. Our team is meeting weekly to pray. Our team is re-upping our postings on college boards and forums and ministry job websites. And because of that, we've gotten 9 new applicants. In 5 weeks, 9 new applicants. That's a good number. We should get excited about that number. We've got 9 new applicants. Afterwards, we've sent several surveys, just so you know our process. We get emails received in. We ask for sermon samples. We watch those. We call references. Then we send a survey. Just gives us a little bit more insight into their life. Then after that survey, if we feel like it, we interview. That's where we really ask the tough questions. We really get to know them. And then they really get to know us. And what I'm so excited about to announce today is after that interview, we ask people to come. And till now, there was one. And it seemed a little off, and it seemed a little weird. Y'all, there's hope, because at least someone is willing to come to Vernal. And God has a man, and there's one coming, and our newest applicant, who has gone all the way through that point, is now coming out the weekend of February 19th through the 21st. You can click the slide there, Roxanne. It's the Collins family. His name is Sean and Kosi, and their little daughter, Mackenzie. And we just got done interviewing them Thursday, and we didn't miss a beat that the Holy Spirit was leading us. We immediately asked them out, and just right around, they said, we'll come out. Now, I want you to know, this isn't like done. This isn't like the end of the process. The process is they come out, they visit, we give them a tour, we get to know them, we get to spend life with them. They preach. You all get the chance to experience who they are as a family and his capabilities as a preacher. We meet again. We talk. Ultimately, after that, we would bring it to you all. So just know, we are still in the process, okay? This isn't the end, but there's hope. Amen. Thank you. Please mark that on your calendar. Week of February 19th, he'll preach Sunday morning, the 21st. Back to Exodus. Oh, I'm sorry. Jericho. We have these walls. We wish it were simple. We wish we could just walk and walk around and around. Remember that, Bill? It's on top of the pile. When we hear the horns, we just go, ha! I would push it, but we need this paper. Tight budget. Wish they would just come crumbling down. Now, I'm not prescribing we do this. Actually, if it'll help, take your bills to your living room. Chant all you want. But I'm not prescribing that's going to work. But what I do want to prescribe is a little bit of faith. Because I think faith works. I believe faith works. The Israelites had faith with Jericho. They saw the walls come down. There's this story in Matthew chapter 17. I love it. You don't have to turn there real quick. I'll just give you the quick recap. There's a demon-possessed boy, and his father sees a son who constantly throws himself into the water and into the flames. And that man in full faith comes to the disciples of Christ and says, my boy has a demon, can you heal him? And the disciples try and they can't. So they go immediately to Jesus, which is a perfect picture of what we should do as a church. We go to Jesus. And Jesus responds, oh, how long do I have to put up with you people? Whatever. It's true. Go read it. But then Jesus heals the demon-possessed boy, and life is found to a new father and a new son. And the disciples ask later on, like, Jesus, why couldn't we? They were shocked that they couldn't. Why? Because just earlier, Jesus had sent him on a ministry tour. He sent him by two. He said, you're going to go into all kinds of towns. You're going to preach the gospel. You're going to do miracles of healing, and you're going to cast out demons. And they go and they went, and then they come back, and right before the feeding of the 5,000, they're all sitting there and they're sharing stories of their success. It says it in the Bible. They shared stories of success. Here are disciples who in faith were going and doing powerful miracles for the Lord. They come to do it again and they go, and they can't heal. Jesus, why couldn't we do it? He said, because you didn't have faith. Even if you had the faith as small as a tiny mustard seed, you'd be able to say these mountains move, and they would move. I just wonder what our plan is going to be. Can I show you my new favorite ministry tool? I love this. I think it's doing wonders for the kingdom. It's called the impossible shot. I got it over here on the stand because this is where I'm going to need my buddy Xander to come on down. Everybody, welcome Xander. For those of you online, it's a poster about this big with a circle this big, and it says impossible shot in really blurry graphics. Xander, hi, how you doing, dude?
Good.
I'm great. I called him yesterday, so he's nervous, I'm sure, but I know he's an avid hunter, and I had heard he's an avid marksman, an expert bow hunter. He says he's not. Okay, Sure. Here's how I use this thing. Xander, you're going to come over here, which is about 15 to 18 paces away. When I have my teens do this, they're about 35 paces in the cold and in the dark. Xander, I'm going to give you this bow, and you just start to get familiar with that. Because in a second, you're going to have three shots to make it through there. Now remember, students do this at twice the distance. Each Wednesday, I give one of my students five shots. Brett's here. Brett! Brett did it! He didn't do it. he tried. He didn't do it. If they hit the board, they get Sonic. They hit it once, they get a drink. They hit it twice, they get a meal. They hit it three times, ain't gonna happen. They get five shots. If they make it through the center of that hole, they get to go to CIY Move 2021 absolutely free. That's $400 that they could win. We've had three people do it each week. Like I said, Brett hit the board. He's the first one to hit the board. Technically, he hit Ethan, who was standing by the board, and then it bounced off Ethan and it hit, so it counts. Xander, you're half the distance, so you get not even a tenth of the prize. I'll give you three shots. If you can make it through that hole, that's a steak dinner for you and your whole family on me. It's a little different kind of bow. So you got these hooks, and they're going to hook in to both of those. And you can really just wind it up, and if you break something, you'll just have to serve to pay it off. Whoa! Xander! That was so close! Oh my gosh! You get Sonic. It's a steak burger. Oh, he got nervous. Xander. Here it is. Ah! Xander, everybody! This, yeah, I know what you're thinking. This was more for me than it was for you. Yep. It's got a point. Quick advertisement, Roxanne, if you would go to that next slide. What is CIY Move 2021? It's a trip we take every single summer. It's for our high school students, 9th through 12th grade. If they're going into high school in the fall, or if they're graduating this May, they can come. Cost is about $400, but all I need is a $50 deposit. We're going to Corvallis, Oregon. We spend a week at the college campus there every single morning, afternoon, and night. Your teens are just having the best worship of their lives, and they're going to encounter Jesus like they've never encountered before. It's going to be fantastic. My goal is always to fundraise and get at least $300 per student. Do the math. $400 trip. They can raise $300. They can raise $350. All I need is a $50 deposit by March 1st. Okay? If you're interested, let me know more. Here's the deal. Why do we call it the impossible shot? It's so small. Right? Why do we call it the impossible shot? It's not impossible. I'll prove it, because Xander's probably wondering. Okay, dart's this big, hole's this big. Everybody saw it. It can go in. In fact, you've got a pretty good radius on this thing. You got three times the size of the bullet. That's pretty good radius. So why lie? Why tell ourselves that's impossible? Looky here. Look at exactly what God has set up for the Israelites. He says, you go around that wall seven times, I'll knock it down. That's impossible. No. If you just have a little faith, what do? Walls come tumbling down. God says, if you would just have a little faith, those mountains could move. You say it's impossible? Jesus says this in Matthew 17, nothing is impossible with God. What's it take? Faith. You just need some faith. And that's where we're at this morning, church. Our plan for the future, what we're going to do, we're going to turn off the impossibles and we're going to turn on the faith. Because God has got this Amen. 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 Last one, and I'll be quick. We're going to check the position. We're going to check our position and make sure we know where we need to be. After everything God did, it was finally the Israelites' time to act. Check it out here in Exodus chapter 14. I'm in verse 15. It says, "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Why are you crying out to me? Tell the people to get moving. Pick up your staff, raise your hands over the sea, divide the water so the Israelites can walk through the middle on the sea ground.'" He says, "Get up, it's time to get moving. I have done everything to put you in the position where I need you, and now it's your turn to act." I want to show you this clip. If you don't know who Francis Chan is, he's a preacher, an amazing preacher. He's a brilliant author. He wrote Crazy Love, real famous. A lot of you have probably heard about it. I love the guy. I love the guy. And in 2020, at the top of the year, he decided he was going to step away from his preaching position, and they were going to move to Hong Kong. His mother is originally from Hong Kong, and he wanted to go minister to the people of Hong Kong. And he ends up picking the same neighborhood that his mother used to witness in. It's super cool, right? So he goes to his children, and he says, "Hey, your mom and I, we're going to Hong Kong." And they say, "Okay, us too." And their kids and their son-in-laws and their grandkids, about 12 of them, all pack up and move together and go to Hong Kong. They start these home churches. It's way cool. And they grow, and it's three different churches and three different homes. They grow to about 15 to 30 people in each church. And in less than a year, their visa gets denied. And they have to come home. And this just happened at the start of 2021. Now, what I want you to hear while you're listening to him is I want you to hear the position they left those churches in. There's three churches. They've got to leave. Here's how they left. Play it, Roxanne.
You know, Justin had to leave first, but he had discipled a guy well, and he was good to go. And then me and Peter are like, "Man, we got like 2 weeks, and then we have to go. And we just want to leave the church in this sustainable place." And so we're looking at these young guys going, "You guys ready? We're going to be taking off in 2 weeks, and we don't know if they'll let us back." And the guys are looking at me going, "No, we're not ready." And I said, "Okay, let me just share two thoughts with you. First, the Apostle Paul would go to a city and he'd be there for like 3 weeks, okay? And they'd never even heard the name of Jesus. And he leaves after leading him to the Lord after a few weeks, and they have no Bible, no resource. How did they do it? All they had was the Holy Spirit. And so are you really not prepared well enough? Some of you guys have been Christians for years, and you've been discipled, and you have your Bible, and you don't feel like you're ready. Is that really what this is about? You don't have enough information, or you don't have enough faith? Because somehow they did it.
Somehow they did it. These churches were fueled by the Holy Spirit. And because of what they did, now 2,000 years later, we ourselves came to accept and believe in that same Spirit. So church, not to call us out, but are we really not ready? Are we really not prepared? I've called this place home for 6 years. I've seen most of you all for that length of time. Many of you were here long before I came. Are we not prepared? We have the information. If we have the Holy Spirit, let's go love people. We were blessed to have our Paul for 20 years. And our Paul got us to take God's word and to hide it in our heart. He got us to move. He got us to mature. We're ready. You stop saying things are impossible. We are here and we are ready to move. Which way are we going to move? We're going to move forward. I'm going to ask the worship team to come on up. Like I said at the start, I have no clue what you want to do with this sermon. But I know where we need to go. As we get ready to move forward, it's time to act. So what are we going to do, church? Man, we're going to surrender more. We are going to get down on our knees and cry out to Jesus more, because that's what the Israelites did. And then we are going to pray more. Somebody say amen. Because we need to pray more. And then we probably need to serve more. And I know that's a little scary. And I know we don't really always have the best plans. But we need to just do it. Amen. And then we need to give more. Because if we give more, God's going to have so much more to do with. And look at what he did with just a little faith. Look at how he's moved mountains before in your life. Look at the ways he's stirring in your heart and getting you to do things that you thought were impossible. Oh, they're not impossible, are they, church? No! Shout it, no! Are they impossible? No! So we're ready. So let's move and let's serve, because when we do, check this out. I know Roxanne showed it. Roxanne, pull up my, you don't have to pull up my last slide. Here's where we're at. When we move, I believe God moves too. I close my Bible. I'm sorry, we're not done. Check this out. Exodus 14, verse 19. Then the angel of the Lord God, who had been leading the people of Israel, moved to the rear of the camp. The pillar of cloud also moved from the front and stood behind them. Y'all, when you get ready to move, when the sea is split and there is dry ground and you take that first step, look at where the Holy Spirit is. He went from leading you to now coming behind you. You are going to move into all impossibilities. Why? Because God is standing right behind you and he's pushing you that way. You don't need to be afraid. You don't need to wonder what's coming. It doesn't matter what's coming. What's coming is goodness. Check this out. Where's your path? When those seas are split and you're going to dry ground, where are you headed, church? Forward to Christ. Look at that. Look at those waves that are being split. Look at that dry ground. Look at what's ahead of you. Oh, I did it on purpose. Because if that's where we know we're moving, what's stopping us? So here's what I want to do. I want you to stand up. Because there is an enemy charging toward us. And that enemy is coming fierce. And he is trying to overtake us, but there is no impossibilities. We just have to, in faith, get God to tear down our walls. So we are going to praise him this morning. We are going to cry out that those walls, those fears would come tumbling down, and then we are going to move, church. Let's sing.
All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. Oh Lord, my prison turns to ruin when your love moves in. All of my fears like Jericho. flesh and bone, crying out to you, Lord, I'm desperate. Love, come rattle this cage and set me free. Cause all of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. Oh Lord, my prison turns to ruin when your love moves in. All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down, come down.
Now listen, you have got to take this and go your own direction with it. You don't need me to tell you what it is. But I do want to say, if you want some walls torn down, I want to pray with you. And if you want to say that I believe God, I want to welcome you to His family. If you need prayer or if you need to make a decision, you come on down while the rest of us sing loud.
Through the tide and the flame, cutting straight to the heart of me. Ooh, long before I ever called your name, you were fighting for my victory. Carved in your flesh and bone, the wounds that have set my soul forgiven. Oh, I can feel the darkness trembling. All of my fears like Jericho. Rebuild me from the ground up. All I want to see is you. Terrify the lies with truth. All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. All of my fears like Jericho walls gotta come down, come down. Oh Lord, my prison turns to ruin.
Father, tear down our walls. We don't need them. We don't want them. We're looking to you. All God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on. Ladies, brunch Saturday. The rest of you, go in peace. Love y'all. Get out of here.
Search the world, but it couldn't fill me.
If anybody happened to find some car keys, Nichelle is looking for them.